Today, we have a special episode for June, which is Men's Health Month. While the podcast is typically targeting issues in prostate health, from time to time, I'll be covering various men's health topics that I feel would be beneficial to our listeners. Now, over the past decade, there has been a surge in low testosterone and erectile dysfunction clinics. Findings from a recent study describing not only the services provided, but also the providers administering these services by standalone commercialized men's health clinics is not only alarming for urologists, but also to consumers. Again, June is Men's Health Month, bringing awareness to men's health issues, and I'm excited to bring in one of the primary investigators from this recent study, which brought forward several concerns regarding these clinics. So stay tuned. So the big question is this: how can men and those who care for them better educate themselves regarding prostate health, the conditions that affect the prostate, and the latest technology in managing these conditions? That is the question, and this podcast will provide the answers. On a weekly basis, we will be chatting with experts, innovators, and leaders in the field of urology, sharing useful information with the general public to improve their lives and increase their overall health. My name is Dr. Garrett Pullman, and welcome to the Prostate Health Podcast. Prostate Health Podcast is for informational purposes only. Nothing in this podcast should be construed as medical advice. By listening to the podcast, no physician-patient relationship has been formed. For more information and counseling, you must contact your personal physician or urologist with questions about your unique situation. It is a pleasure to introduce Dr. Jagan Kansal to our listeners here at the Prostate Health Podcast. Dr. Kansal is currently concluding fellowship training in men's sexual and reproductive health at the Medical College of Wisconsin in Milwaukee. He did his urology residency training at the University of Cincinnati. Upon completion of his men's health fellowship, he'll be soon leading the Men's Health Center at the DuPage Medical Group in DuPage County, Illinois, a multi-specialty group in Chicago. Dr. Kansal, thank you for joining us today on the Prostate Health Podcast.
Well, thanks so much for having me. I think these podcasts are just are wonderful. Anything we can do to further educate patients in this field is phenomenal. So I appreciate the opportunity for you to let me talk about a topic that I'm very passionate about.
You bet. So Dr. Kansal, over the past decade, we have seen a surge in these standalone low testosterone and erectile dysfunction commercialized clinics. Now, the current literature surrounding the practice patterns of these low T and ED clinics have been sparse. And because of this, you and several other co-investigators just recently concluded a study looking at these men's health clinics, which was recently presented at the American Urologic Association 2020 virtual meeting. Before we get into the details of the study, could you first tell our listeners a bit about standalone commercialized men's health clinics and what are some of the treatments being prescribed and administered at these clinics?
Yeah, as you said, you know, over the past decade, there's just been a huge increase in the concept of men's health. I think diving into a little bit of what men's health is, the main centers that we'll talk about focus on low testosterone and erectile dysfunction. I think we as urologists know that there's some issues related to these men's health clinics. And so really the goal that I want to impress on your listeners and whoever else is listening is, you know, which ones are the good men's health centers to go to? Who is actually trained in this? And what are some of the good treatment options that you can get? You know, with such a large increase in the desire to have treatment, you start having people try to treat these conditions that might not have the formalized training. So I think, like I said, education is a very, very important aspect. What I'm trying to do is to educate patients on what the treatments are and who they should go to get treatment. So I think from a patient and provider standpoint, I think there's a lot about some of the treatments that we'll discuss that is actually people don't know about it. So even as a provider, you know, they might not be aware that they're prescribing a treatment that is different than what is described in the literature. So after, you know, 5 years of residency training and now doing a fellowship specifically in sexual medicine and reproductive medicine, you know, I'm just starting to understand this. And so, you know, it does take a lot of training to really understand the ins and outs of low T and erectile dysfunction. And whether it be a provider that's treating it that doesn't have that expertise or whether it be a patient looking for that treatment, I think like having these podcasts and trying to educate patients is extremely important. And I'm very passionate about this topic.
Well, thank you again for coming on. So, and I'm really happy to have you on the show today because I understand some of the findings from this study should be eye-opening and alarming, not only for urologists, but also consumers. Could you first tell our listeners, you know, a bit about the study and how it was conducted?
Absolutely. So, you know, these men's health centers, like I said, are kind of all over the country. The three main treatment options that we decided to focus on was you know, first erectile dysfunction, there's things called penile injections. There's something called platelet-rich plasma or PRP. And then there's a treatment called shockwave. And all three of these, especially the PRP and shockwave, have been relatively new. And they've kind of exploded on the field. So, you know, later on in the show, I'd like to go over some of the evidence and some of the different terminology associated with it. But, you know, from a patient perspective, it's really hard to understand what the different treatments are and why one is better than the other. And without having that knowledge or expertise in this particular field, I think it's really difficult to choose one of these options or choose one of these clinics as a patient. So, you know, like I said, we as urologists, we see patients going to these men's health centers all the time, and we see kind of the consequence of that. You know, whether they come saying, hey, the treatment's too expensive that they're offering, it didn't work for me, you know, I had a complication from it, or just the fact that they want to have a relationship with their provider because it's more of a long-term treatment option. I mean, you know, there's a multitude of reasons why we see patients, but we're trying to address, instead of going to these, you know, some of these places first, maybe with more education, they can avoid, you know, those things I mentioned before. And so that's kind of why we decided to look at them. We wanted to do a study to really address some of these things to provide a little bit more education.
Great. Well, I would love to get into some of the details of the study and what you found. Could you give us some background information about the treatments that you found were being offered at some of these clinics?
Absolutely. So one of the main issues that we had when we started to look at these men's health centers is there's virtually no data that's available. So, you know, these are all, a lot of these clinics are private and we just can't get access to the data or the patients that are being seen there. So we thought the easiest way to look at something is to find the most readily available data, and that's just websites. I think that's important for a couple different reasons, but mainly I think this is the first point of contact for patients. So everyone's going on the internet and trying to find information. And so we really wanted to see what these websites are actually showing patients or telling patients and what they're advertising. So we thought that was a good place to start, and that's what our study focuses on. So to kind of get into a little bit of details of the study, we looked at as many men's health centers in the country as possible that had websites, and we ended up looking at over almost 230 clinics and evaluating to see how many of them are offering some of these treatments, what they're telling patients, if there's any cost-related information about it. And so those are some of the things that we tried to address in this study. And I think it's one of the first ones kind of looking at this market just because, like I said, there's just not a lot of data for us to analyze. So we thought this was the best way to start.
Perfect. So some of the treatments that you focused on in some of these clinics, you know, that are offering injection, the PRP and shockwave therapy, how about penile shockwave therapy? How is this treatment delivered?
Yeah. So this is one of the hot topics right now in men's health. So, you know, if you go online or look at any, you know, billboards everywhere, shockwave is a hot topic right now. So as part of the education process, just really briefly, you know, there are two main, I guess, categories of treatment for ED. One actually addresses the ED, meaning they just, our goal is to get them to have a functional erection. So there's a whole host of treatments related to that. There's, you know, Viagra and PDE5 inhibitors. There are vacuum pump devices. There are injections, all that kind of stuff. And then there's a whole separate class of ED treatments called restorative therapies. And those are the new ones that people have, you know, obviously there's a lot of marketing associated with it, but people are really starting to look into that a little bit. So the first one that you had mentioned was shockwave. So shockwave, I think the main problem with shockwave is that it's really loosely defined in the media. So everything that you see online is called shockwave, but there's so many different types of actual shockwave devices. And I think it's really important for the patient and the provider to understand the differences. So essentially the whole idea of shockwave is to stimulate the erectile tissue of the penis so that it actually undergoes some damage and that your body naturally starts to heal itself. When it heals itself, new blood vessels are formed. And so that increased in blood vessel or vascularity of the penis is what actually causes you to have better erections. So that's the overall general idea of what a shockwave is. But I think one thing that we found in our study that's really important is that most of these men's health centers are actually offering something called acoustic wave therapy. Now, the problem is the shockwave and acoustic waves are being used interchangeably. And there's a really big difference in those two technologies. So, you know, with acoustic wave therapies, they're, by definition, they are a therapy. The acoustic waves actually travel at the same speed of sound. That's the whole theory of acoustic waves. What shock waves are is that the waves travel faster than the speed of sound. And by definition, acoustic waves don't change the media from which they pass through. So if you have an acoustic wave in water, air, in our situation, erectile tissue, it's not actually changing the tissue that it's going through. It's just making a sound, basically. Whereas shock wave, because it's traveling faster than the speed of sound, it actually is creating changes in the tissue, which is what ultimately leads to the success of these treatments. Furthermore, you know, we looked at kind of FDA classifications, and I think this is really eye-opening to me and a lot of providers, is the reason why these acoustic wave therapies or quote-unquote shockwave therapies are all over the market is that the FDA classifies these acoustic wave therapies as a class one medical device. And, you know, I looked at other class one medical devices, and things like Band-Aids, stethoscopes, electric toothbrushes are class one devices. And basically, a class one device basically says there's no risk for taking it, but there's really not a benefit, meaning that it's not going to harm the patient, but there's no significant advantage because you're not changing the tissue. So all of these men's health centers, or a lot of them, all these men's health centers don't understand that acoustic wave therapy, even though it's advertised as shockwave therapy, is not true shockwave therapy. So if when patients look at the websites and they look at all the studies that they're quoting, is you have to understand the fundamental difference that these studies that have been done on shockwave have actually used shockwaves and not acoustic waves. So you really want to look for men's health centers that know the difference. You want to look for providers that understand that you actually want a device that actually gives you shockwaves, because that will lead to changes in the tissue, which will ultimately might help your erectile dysfunction. And that's actually an FDA class two device because they're a little bit more serious. They can change the tissue. A class one device, the acoustic waves device, there is absolutely no evidence that it helps with erectile dysfunction. So I think that's a really big key point that I want to stress, because I think from a provider standpoint and a patient standpoint, it's important to understand the difference.
Yeah. Wow. That's a great distinction there. And one that probably even a lot of urologists don't realize that there's a difference there. Again, so to kind of recap that, two different types of devices, the acoustic wave and a shock wave, with the, you know, the acoustic wave not really having a lot of data to support, you know, it's not changing that tissue. And kind of in your findings, what at some of these men's health clinics were most of them using the shock wave, or was it more the acoustic wave that you were finding?
So almost all of them are all acoustic wave, and that's the problem. And they go by a ton of different names, but if the patient actually goes and kind of reads the description of what the device is, it'll actually say acoustic wave on it. So if it says acoustic wave, that is not true shockwave therapy, and it's not the studies that have looked at actual shockwaves. Those are not the devices that they've looked at. And so once again, it's just kind of educating the patients that, you know, there's a big loose definition of shock waves. And while an acoustic wave is advertised as a shock wave, it's not necessarily that. And like you said, there's no clinical data at all to show that acoustic waves have any influence on erectile dysfunction. But there is evidence showing that shock waves have an effect. So there are a couple different trials that have looked at this, and there's one currently going on at the University of Miami, and they're in a phase two. They actually just started a phase three trial on shockwave therapy, and they've shown that there is a benefit to actual shockwave therapy. Now, when you talk about the severity of ED, that's a whole different conversation. But right now, from a men's health point of view, we think shockwave therapy, it may be appropriate for certain patients, especially with mild ED, people that really don't want to take the Viagra or the Cialis kind of thing, where they want to try to get back to a normal erection without taking medications. You know, it might be an option for them. Not so much for, you know, potentially the post-prostatectomy guy that needs injections, or the injections aren't working. You know, it's not going to be a one thing cure all erectile dysfunction treatment. So we're still trying to figure out who the ideal patient is. But what we're thinking is patients with mild, maybe moderate ED, this could be a restorative option for them. But it's really, really important to understand you need to get a device and a provider that understands the difference between shockwaves and acoustic wave therapy.
Thank you for that. So you mentioned platelet-rich plasma treatments being delivered at some of these commercialized clinics. So how is this administered, and what is this?
Yeah, so this is the other really highly marketable thing that people have started doing. PRP, like you said, is platelet-rich plasma. It goes by a number of different things, just like shockwave. So in the literature, when you look up men's health clinics, there's something called PRP. Some call it the P shot. Some people call it the pride piss shot. There's a whole variety of things that people call it. But once again, this is another restorative treatment option that people have tried to look into. What's even more interesting in PRP is that there's even less data on PRP than there is on shockwave. Now, there's no clinical trials in the U.S. yet looking at PRP. There's one that just got accepted once again from University of Miami with Tom Masterson and Dr. Ramasamy are looking at PRP specifically. But the whole idea of PRP, similar to shockwave, is that we want to try to help patients restore their own natural erections by increasing the blood flow to the penis. So the concept originated in the orthopedic literature, but essentially what they're doing is they're taking the blood. So you get a blood draw from the patient. They spin the blood down so that you only get the platelet-rich plasma part of it. And then they're just taking that, basically the platelets or the plasma and the platelets, and they're injecting it into the penis. The idea is that when you get hurt or a wound complication, let's say, you have a release of platelets that go to that area, and the platelets release certain chemicals that increase blood cell or blood vessel development. So the idea is, hey, you know, with erectile tissue, maybe we can inject these platelets and maybe it'll stimulate angiogenesis or, you know, a blood vessel development in the penis, which will help erectile dysfunction. The idea, like I said, came from orthopedic literature, especially with musculoskeletal things, so like joints, tendons. Joints and tendons have a very difficult time repairing. It takes a long time for those to repair. And the reason that is because there's limited blood flow that gets to that area. So the idea is, hey, maybe we can help stimulate that by injecting platelets into that area because there's a lack of blood flow. And while there is some data that it helps with orthopedic stuff, there, like I said, there's absolutely no data right now that shows that PRP is an effective treatment option for ED right now.
So the other, you know, things that you looked at in the study, which I'm curious to see what you found, was, you know, the types of providers administering these treatments at these commercialized low T and ED clinics, as far as what you found in your study.
Yeah, so I think this was kind of eye-opening to us, and I think it's a known thing from urologists, but I think to actually get a number or an idea of it is important. So, you know, like I said, from my background, we, as well as you, you know, we train in urology. We do a 5 or 6 year residency in urology. Some people decide to do a fellowship in a certain area. You know, I decided to do men's sexual and reproductive health. And so, you know, we get formalized training in men's health. And what I mean by men's health is we get formalized training in treating erectile dysfunction. What I thought was really interesting is that there are a huge host of medical providers in different specialties that are treating erectile dysfunction. So in our study, we found that there was 17 different specialties that are attempting to treat erectile dysfunction, even though they might not have the formalized training or any training at all for erectile dysfunction. What's also kind of interesting is that 26% of the websites had no information on who the provider was. So when I tell patients, you know, when they're looking at men's health clinics, is to look who's actually treating you. And if they don't have that information on who the provider is or what their background is, I'd be a little skeptical to go to them because they're just not providing that information. And sometimes they're not providing that information for a reason, you know. But, you know, I think what's interesting from our standpoint is that only about 7% of men's health clinics had a urologist associated with it. Furthermore, with low T, like we were talking about before, is, you know, low T is a little bit different. There's other providers that get formalized training in low T. For example, endocrinologists get training in low testosterone. Family medicine doctors sometimes do, and internal medicine docs sometimes treat this as well. So it's a little bit more broad of a category. But even then, you know, 91 to 92% of clinics did not have a urologist or an endocrinologist on staff when they're treating low testosterone. So, you know, I think this is very, very important. I think I'm obviously passionate about this topic. I'm passionate for a lot of reasons, but one of the main reasons is guys are just not good at going to the doctor. You know, once we get the man into the clinic, or, you know, we get them as a patient, not only do they not come into the doctor's office, they're not good at talking about very personal issues. I mean, we're talking about sexual function and reproductive function, and it's a very sensitive topic. So I really think you need a specialized person with formalized training, whether it be a urologist or even endocrinologist, to really treat you for either low testosterone or erectile dysfunction.
Yeah. Wow. And you would think that this, you know, definitely raises some concern regarding, you know, potential qualification of some of the providers offering these treatments at the clinics, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, when I try to explain things to patients, I try to use terminology that, you know, they'll understand. So one of the conditions I always tell patients is I talk about asthma. So asthma is a very common thing. People understand asthma and they understand it's a chronic condition. So I basically tell patients, you know, I understand the basics of asthma. You know, I could prescribe you the newest and greatest inhaler potentially, but what I can't do is I don't have the expertise and I've received no formalized training in the duration, the frequency of using the inhaler, how long you should be doing it. And I don't know when I should have you follow up to make sure it's actually working. You know, it's not just like I give you an inhaler and all of a sudden you're cured from asthma. You know, it's a long-term problem that you want to go to a medical specialist. The other thing that I think is really serious that's important, and this gets in more of the injection therapy. So one of the main problems with injections is that you can get something called priapism. So, you know, if you get priapism, and what I mean by priapism is if your erection lasts for more than 4 hours, it can be a medical emergency. So similar to asthma kind of analogy is if I prescribe you an inhaler and you get a complication from that inhaler, I don't know what to do to treat it. And so I'm just going to tell you to go to the emergency room. So I'm a firm believer of if you're going to prescribe a treatment to a patient, you should be able to deal with the complications associated with that treatment. So all urologists prescribing injections know how to deal with emergencies. These other providers that don't have formalized training in erectile dysfunction or don't have the qualifications or knowledge and to deal with complications associated with these treatments. And so that's one of the frustrations we have as urologists is they're providing the treatment, but then they don't have any recourse on if something goes wrong. And so that's where some of the frustration comes into as urologists. And it's no fault of their own. They just didn't get the formalized training to do this, right? But I think the providers need to realize that, you know, it's important to be able to treat complications associated with the treatments you're prescribing.
So of the clinics offering these ED treatments, how many did you find that were advertising the PRP plasma, you know, treatments and as well as the shockwave therapy treatments?
Yeah, so this was kind of alarming to us. I mean, this is kind of the basis of one of our main focal points of the study is that we found 60% were offering PRP and we found over 66% were offering shockwave therapy. And that is, I mean, you're talking about 2/3 of all the clinics that we've looked at, which is, like I said, over 200, 230 clinics that are offering shockwave and or PRP. And once again, a majority, almost all of the clinics are offering acoustic wave therapy, which has no proven benefit in erectile dysfunction. And by definition, it doesn't change the tissue that, you know, the media is passing through. PRP even has less data than shockwave, and people are, you know, 60% are advertising that. And then finally, over half these clinics are offering injections. So there's a term called shock clinics, and some people have heard of these shock clinics. There's a lot of different ways to treat erectile dysfunction, but some of these clinics are just offering injections. And we found that 52% were offering injections, and 27% of those were the only treatment they listed on their website was injections. They didn't talk about any other Viagras, PDE5s, vacuums, you know, penile prosthesis. They didn't talk about anything else but shots. So I think this was a big finding, I guess, in terms of how alarming it is to us that it's that common and 2/3 of these clinics are offering them.
And a quick clarification for our listeners. So when we're talking about the shots, again, different from the PRP shots, correct, or injections?
Yeah, thanks for clarifying. Yeah, so penile injections are an actual medication that's proven to actually give you an erection. It's very well researched. They're very common. Most urologists use them for some form of erectile dysfunction. The PRP injections are completely different. So that's the restorative option that we were talking about. I mean, that's where they actually just take your blood, spin it down, take the platelets out of that, and then inject it into the penis. And so, yeah. Absolutely. Great point. Two different treatment options for sure.
Now with the clinics advertising the PRP injections, did you see anything in terms of what they were marketing for results? You know, any information on, you know, on how many treatments they were recommending?
Yeah. So this is one thing that's also kind of alarming is that the expectations these clinics are selling to the patients is that this is the one and only cure-all treatment. And you do it one time and you're going to be cured for erectile dysfunction for the rest of your life. We know that's not true. We know it's a chronic condition. And if it sounds too good, it is probably too good to be true. You know, I'm not saying that, you know, that these treatment options are wrong to offer, but what I get frustrated with is these clinics are selling patients on these treatment options. So I'm okay with having a discussion with the patient and even offering, hey, shockwave might be good for you. PRP is very investigational, and we have no data on it. But I think the patients have some right to choose what treatment option they want to get. And I'm totally, absolutely agree with that. But what's happening is these clinics are trying to sell these treatments. And that's where I think we as providers, especially in urology that specialize in erectile dysfunction, really need to start educating patients that this is a problem. And like I said, it's probably too good to be true. One injection is not going to cure your erectile dysfunction. And you really need to establish a long-term relationship with the provider that knows what they're talking about to start curing or addressing your erectile dysfunction.
Now, was the cost of PRP and shockwave listed on these websites? Now, again, and correct me if I'm wrong, but you know, these types of therapies typically carry significant out-of-pocket expenses, correct?
Absolutely. So very, very minimal data out there. Almost none of the clinics we reviewed had any information about cost of PRP or shockwave therapy. And yes, you're absolutely correct. They are not covered by insurance, mainly because, once again, they're investigational and experimental right now. So virtually no insurance companies will cover PRP or shockwave. So yes, they're, you know, we don't have the data because, once again, the websites don't list the actual cost information. But we have anecdotal data all the time when patients are coming into our office and telling us how much these treatments are. But thousands of dollars people are spending on shockwave or PRP. And we're talking, you know, like $500 per treatment. People are getting 6 to 12 treatments. I mean, you're looking at anywhere $3,000, $6,000, $10,000 sometimes for these treatments. And the other thing that we talked about is that we don't know how many treatments we should give you, and we don't know the frequency of treatments. We have some data on shockwaves to kind of have a rough estimate of it, but some people are just giving one injection of PRP and charging thousands of dollars. Some people are giving 2 injections, 6 injections, 12 injections. We just don't know. And so people that may not have the expertise in erectile dysfunction are kind of making clinical judgments on how many PRP shots you should get, but there's no data behind that to support it. So what I tell patients is, it's fine if you want to try those treatment options. I'm here to give you that information saying exactly what I'm telling you now. But if it's costing you $10,000 for a treatment option that has no proven benefit right now, especially, like I said, with the acoustic wave therapy with shockwaves, you know, I would really think twice or at least get a second opinion from a provider that has a little bit more knowledge on these treatment options.
Yeah. Well, certainly concerning to see so many clinics offering investigational treatments outside of a clinical trial, which, you know, have the potential for significant out-of-pocket expenses to the patient. Now, in regards to testosterone therapy, what were some of the findings of the study, you know, based on this, what you were seeing in these clinics?
Yeah, so the main thing with testosterone is that it's been kind of known as vitamin T almost, right? So everyone is taking it. No one really understands, like, you know, what levels should be optimized. And the problem with testosterone or low T symptoms is they're kind of vague, right? So, you know, we ask patients, are you having trouble sleeping at night? Are you having fatigue during the day? Are you, is your libido decreased? You know, they're kind of vague symptoms. And so, you know, when we ask patients those questions, we need to kind of figure out, hey, is this testosterone related or not? And so what's, you know, kind of the accepted guideline is that we should shoot for a testosterone around 300 to 600. Now, once again, that's not set in stone. We treat patients on testosterone based on their symptoms rather than, you know, really define values. But if you have a patient that's coming in with a testosterone 800, 900 or even 1,000, you know, what we found was a lot of clinics online are advertising that they actually want and their goal is to get their testosterone to those levels. So they don't even mention, hey, we want to address your symptoms. We want to look at what level is ideal for you. They're just saying, we want to optimize your testosterone so it's between 800 and 1200. I mean, there's no data showing that your testosterone of that high is going to be any different than their testosterone of 300 to 400. Now, that being said, I think it's really important to understand that we are treating their symptoms, right? So if you have a testosterone of 200 and we get it to 400 and your symptoms get dramatically better, great. You know, we have some guys that come in with testosterones of 400 to 500 and we trial them on testosterone. We get their testosterone maybe to 700, 800, a little bit higher, and they feel better. Well, maybe testosterone made a difference. But it's important to know that testosterone requires follow-up. And it's not just, I'm going to give you an injection or whatever we're going to prescribe you, and all of a sudden you're going to feel better. It's not a cure-all for everything, but it is helpful for some patients. But you really need to follow up because it's not just a benign or harm-free vitamin that you're taking. It is a serious medication that can have effects, whether it be, you know, cancer-related or, you know, blood counts. You know, there's a lot of things testosterone can cause later down the road. So it does require some frequent monitoring. And I think that's important to know is, you know, how much monitoring is this clinic's given you? And I think it's important to really understand that, you know, you need to come in for regular checkups, you need to come in for regular lab tests. And so I think what we found on the study is more just unrealistic expectations and not a clear goal of what the goal for testosterone replacement is.
Well, this has been very helpful so far, really valuable information for our listeners. I know we're starting to run out of time here on the podcast, but I know a lot of men also have questions about, you know, how they go about supplementing their testosterone. But not only that, but also men who've had treatment for prostate cancer, they want to know, you know, when and if can they go back on their testosterone supplement. So for our listeners, we're going to be recording some bonus video content today with Dr. Kansal for the upcoming launch of the Prostate Health Academy. So for those that are interested, including other behind the scenes recordings with our podcast guests, just sign up for our wait list to make sure you have the chance to access all of this when it launches. Just go to prostatehealthacademy.com. Again, that's prostatehealthacademy.com. Scroll down and sign up for our waitlist. We'll also be doing something special for those on our waitlist at the time of the launch. So in summary, Dr. Kansal, you've really done an excellent job in bringing several concerns with your study, characterizing not only the variance in the type of providers delivering the services at these men's health clinics, the majority of which did not have a urologist or endocrinologist on staff, but also the types of treatments being marketed by these clinics, including, you know, non-evidence-based, which are not standard of care treatment. So Dr. Kansal, any final thoughts for our listeners today?
Yeah, I think the main thing I do want to impress upon, you know, I've talked a lot about the risks of men's health centers, but I do want to impress upon patients that not all men's health centers are bad. You know, I think they really have had powerful marketing to bring some important topics to guys, which are not, like I said, very good at going to the doctor. But I think what the patient needs to do, or try to do at least, and that's what we're trying to educate the patients on, is finding the right men's health center, finding the right providers that know what they're talking about. And also understand that even though you want to get treated for erectile dysfunction or low T, let's say, you don't necessarily need to go to an advertised men's health center. So urologists treat this condition all the time without advertising themselves as men's health centers. So, you know, here in Wisconsin, I'm training under Dr. Amy Geis, James Matthews, who's the PA that does it. And we're part integrated with the urology program. It's not a separate men's health clinic that we're treating patients. But clearly, I mean, Dr. Geis is an national expert on this topic. That's why I decided to spend an extra year here training with her specifically. And so I think what provider or what patients should try to do is, one, look for a provider or a men's health center in your area that has a provider that specializes in men's health. Whether that be a urologist for erectile dysfunction or whether it be an endocrinologist or an internal medicine doc for hypogonadism or low T, I think doing the due diligence of a little bit of research before will definitely help patients in the long run. And then also, you know, if there are no dedicated men's health centers per se that are advertised, go to your local urologist. And there's urologists in every city. And if they may not offer Shockwave or they might not offer PRP, but they at least will give a little bit information regarding treatment options for erectile dysfunction. And, you know, when you're armed with knowledge and you're armed with that data, you know, if you end up going to the men's health center and trying Shockwave, at least you'll know the difference and be able to ask appropriate questions. Is this Shockwave? Is this acoustic wave? How many treatments am I getting? Who's giving the treatments? All those kind of things. So, you know, I think that's the main focus that I wanted to bring out was not all men's health centers are bad. There are excellent providers that treat this. If there's no men's health centers in your area per se that are being advertised, your local urologists all have formalized training in erectile dysfunction. So I highly recommend you treat or at least seek those providers out. And for patients that have a hard time finding places, almost every city has specialists in this field. So, you know, I'm happy to answer emails or I'm happy to answer questions on Twitter about, you know, my opinion on a men's health center. If you're interested, I'm happy to answer any more questions to my knowledge on some of these options. So I think he'll, you know, Dr. Pullman will include my information on the website and my email address. My Twitter handle is my first name, which is Jagan Kansal, Kansal, MD. And I'm happy to, you can send me a message on that. It's open. I'm happy to answer your questions on that way. Or my email address, which will be on the website for you guys to email me directly. Happy to help. So thanks so much. I really appreciate it. I really passionate about men's health. And I think educating patients is extremely, extremely important.
Well, thank you for that. And it certainly was a joy to chat with you today on the Prostate Health Podcast. You've definitely given a lot of valuable information today for our listeners here for Men's Health Month. So thank you again.
Absolutely. Thanks so much for having me.
Thank you again for listening to the Prostate Health Podcast. We would love to have you join our podcast Facebook group at www.facebook.com/groups/Prostate Health Podcast. Or just use the Facebook group search function and search for the Prostate Health Podcast and ask to join. We'll see you at the next episode.